We have two representatives of the Shakespeare Festival with us today. Speaking first will be Festival Artistic Director Jerry Turner, director of Heartbreak House. Jerry guides the artistic path of the festival in general. Working closely with him is Portland Center Stage producer Dennis Bigelow, who's responsible for the hiring of all artistic personnel at the Portland Company. Dennis will direct the second production of the premier season, Steel Magnolias, set to officially open tomorrow. Jerry Turner has been the artistic leader of the company since 1971, when he took over the reins from festival founder Angus Bomer. He's directed over 50 productions in Ashland. Dennis Bigelow was most recently producing director at the Sacramento Theater Company, where for the past 5 years he guided that company from a community theater to a professional company with a budget of well over $1 million. Dr. Turner and Mr. Bigelow will address the problems and challenges of opening a new theater company, and the uniqueness of the Ashland-Portland satellite company arrangement. First, Jerry Turner.
About an hour ago, I didn't expect to be here. We have one of those awful things that plagued Southern Oregon of a fogged-in airport. I think they found the exact foggiest spot on the entire West Coast before they decided to build there. So, well, I've been waiting in that airport since about 6:30 this morning. It rolled around to about 10:30, and I finally called Dennis and says, "I'm not going to make it," which threw everybody into panic. So if I seem a little more breathless than usual, that's why. Angus Bomer, the founder of our theater in Ashland, once told me a story of a conversation he had had with his teacher, the distinguished actor and director B. Iden Payne, after a particularly inspiring lecture on the nature of the Elizabethan playhouse. "You should write all this out in a book," Angus said. Payne's reply was provocative. "It's not a thing to be written about," he said. "It's a thing to be done." I'm reminded of this today because, having launched the opening season of Portland Center Stage, an enterprise of great pitch and moment, we are now constrained also to talk about it. It is Voltaire who said, "I plow, but I do not write about plowing." Surely it's more important to act than to explain an action. And certainly there is some danger that an explanation undertaken before an action has had time enough to define itself runs the danger of sicklying over the native hue of resolution with the pale cast of thought, thus losing some of the power of the act itself. Every action is, however, not universally applauded, nor for a single reason. A good play frequently is measured not by the unity of admiration it inspires, but by the controversy it stirs in its audience. A classic is, almost by definition, capable of a variety of interpretations. If it isn't, it's either dead or, worse, a deadly truism. Besides, good conversation has a way of helping to define an unclear and ambiguous situation. In the third act of Heartbreak House, the heroine Ellie Dunn finds her goal: life with a blessing. "There's a blessing on my broken heart. There's a blessing on your beauty, Hesione. There's a blessing on your father's spirit. Even on the lies of Marcus, there is a blessing. But on Mr. Mangan's money, there is none." When challenged as to what she means, she answers, "I don't know, but I know it means something." And it does, because she's found a phrase that defines exactly her aim in life. A city's soul is an ambiguous thing, as ambiguous as Ellie's blessing. We all know that there are great-souled cities and small-souled cities, though I don't intend to make any unnecessary comparisons here. I like to think a civic pride in its cultural life is the mark of a great-souled city, but I can't be sure of it, any more than Ellie could precisely define what blessing meant, nor why Mangan's millions would not qualify. Size and affluence have some importance, no doubt, but are not the only factors in the growth of a soul, or even very important. London in the 16th century was geographically and economically quite small, but its soul must have been enormous to have produced a Shakespeare. growing up in the Middle West, Portland was to me a city either in Oregon on the West Coast or Maine on the East Coast. Like a lot of others, I used to get them mixed up, since both of them were located on oceans I had never seen. Later, having moved west, I became conscious of the city as a rather large, congested metropolis on the way to Seattle, without much to distinguish it from other places of a similar size. I knew by then several people, including my wife, who had lived in Portland, who spoke of it with affection, but without the same pride and attachment one associates with San Franciscans or Denverites. I knew it was a relatively young city, and I thought of it as essentially unformed. Years later, I found on a visit to a farm in Småland, Sweden, a photograph of Portland in the 20s, carefully preserved by a distant relative of mine from that country. It was the city of his birth. For him, it represented his roots. It was the old country. He had no memories beyond the photograph. Sometime in the 70s, the city, or I, or perhaps both, began to change. I became aware of the sheer physical beauty of the site, and under the pressure of urban renewal in part, Portland seemed to stretch itself slowly into an awareness of its muscle, its mind, and its soul. For one thing, the Trailblazers were winning. But it would be wrong to ascribe the renewal I sensed merely to athletic chauvinism. There simply was a new confidence and energy in the air. Destiny was no longer assumed, but planned for, created, believed. Old Portland was not shelved for a new city, but rather created anew in a consciousness of the past, an excitement in the present, and a vision in the future. By now, of course, I had become an Oregonian. I was a citizen of the Northwest. My civilization was being shaped to a great degree by the same forces that were reshaping Portland. Nationally, Americans were experiencing something like a renaissance in the arts. I was part of that movement. As an artist, I had hopes and expectations that a new professional theater would take root in that fertile and lively city to the north. I wanted to help bring it into being. Americans as a whole are overly self-conscious and unsure about aesthetic things. Words like beauty, culture, art, spirit do not come easy to a people who are ruled by harsh utilitarian necessity. Jefferson is praised for his pragmatic politics and the Louisiana Purchase, but less so for designing Monticello or for founding the University of Virginia. It's not surprising that in a country only recently wrested from the wilderness, cultural and artistic values should be the last to flourish. But they lie closer to what I have referred to as a city's soul than a lot of values we pay more attention to. To be civilized, to be a citizen, to create a civil order, is to behave as a member of a city, itself an expression of a collective will and shared values. Today, of course, Americans seem much more willing than in the immediate past to give lip service to the idea of the arts, but expenditures for artistic graces sometimes are treated as if they were intended for something else. The arts as enticement to a flourishing tourist economy, for example, is frequently cited as a reason for support. Or the arts are treated as one of the many consumer baubles of the elite market, an upper-class example of conspicuous consumption. Or on a more popular level, the arts become merely a segment of the entertainment industry, an alternative to Hollywood or a VCR. It's perfectly natural that the theater should be so regarded. There is a commercial value assigned by the market to works of art. Theaters have been known to pander to the lowest common denominator of public taste. Some have capitalized on snobbishness and elitism. But a responsible theater seeks to serve its audience rather than to exploit them. And if it serves that audience well, it seeks to find stories and themes that have a profound resonance in the spiritual life of the city. I don't mean it necessarily deals with social problems or develops by political activism. The most vital part of theater is no more in service to sociology and politics than it is in service to entertainment, adornment, or tourism. But it dare not be indifferent to civic concerns, and if it serves its audience well, it must be taken seriously as a restive but important critic indispensable to the city's life. Portland Center Stage need not be merely local, but it should incorporate local vibes, to use a word popular in the 60s. It must not be seen as an imported artifact filling an elaborate warehouse on Broadway, One cannot import a culture. Culture is organic. It must be nourished. We share, of course, a common history, not only with Great Britain, but with Western Europe. In a larger sense, we are part of a planetary experience. But the first great playwright whose voice is distinctly American, Eugene O'Neill, was born only 100 years ago. After O'Neill, the American theater ceased to be a colonial and became part of a national consciousness. In the same way, Portland Center Stage will take its place in the fullest sense only when it speaks unequivocally as Portland's cultural voice. I do not suggest that it should be the only voice, or even the most important voice, but that it be unmistakably at home. Institutions do not come quickly, nor are they cheap. A vital theater will never appeal to a huge, unsophisticated audience. It will always be in need of additional money, not to mention occasional praise for less than splendid work. But when a theater functions well, it can feed the spirit of its audiences as few other institutions can, and its influence can extend far beyond its walls to people whose knowledge of the theater as art form is negligible. A vibrant city is a city conscious of itself. It is confident without complacency, assured, not boastful, unhesitating, but not unquestioning. Its standards are high, but not unreachable. It is demanding, but not intolerant. And it is never, never indulgent nor vulgar. It is, in short, civilized.
Well, this morning while Jerry was sitting at the Medford Airport fogged in, I suddenly thought I would have to do this alone and suffered an extraordinary morning of anxiety because it would be possible for me to use words as eloquent as Jerry just spoke. That, however, is one of the magical parts of theater. We exist here today as a brand new theater company. The company is based upon collaboration. It is easy for us to describe the microcosm of that. Our collaboration exists between a director and a cast, between a couple of designers, people who build, administrators, fundraisers, Jerry and I, as cohorts. The collaboration also must extend to Portland, because as Jerry said, that is who we are striving to serve, the citizens of Portland. In many ways, our presence here differs from the reality of the theater 300 miles south. The reality of that theater, which seems extraordinary, is that people come from very far away to spend a week, a weekend, a couple times a year. We call it a destination theater. We do not call it a tourist theater. It is your destination when you set out. Very few people, in my experience, set out to drive from Seattle to San Francisco and, oh, just happen to stop by this charming little town called Ashland. It has become its own identity. It is an extraordinary place. Here, our goals are very different and difficult to define at this point, because we do not know you terribly well. As producer, I'm residing here in Portland, and it becomes my task simply to try to determine what you want and what you need, because I think that's what theater, that's what culture must be. And when we sit down to choose a season of plays, you must be taken into consideration. We're very new. We have opted to do a season of 5 plays this year. That reflects a 53-year history of being an extraordinarily literate theater. And I hope that our season reflects that. We opened with Shaw's Heartbreak House, and it was wonderful. I can't tell you the surprise that I took standing in the lobby talking to audience members after the show, when they came out. And people start to recognize me, you know. They put your picture in the program book, and then, you know, you're the guilty one or the good one. And believe me, you get both sides of that coin. And people came up. It was, to me, an extraordinarily entertaining and thought-provoking evening. And when that sentiment was echoed by so many people in the audience, I felt very happy to be here. I'm feeling finally that I found a home here in Portland, and that I have to get to know this collective called the audience. This is a major tense day for me, because last night we had our first preview of Steel Magnolias, which is the first show I'm directing here, and tonight we have yet another preview, which I know some people in this room are going to attend. And tomorrow night we open our second show. It seems to me we are eclectic. And what makes us such good collaborators is that Jerry brings a style to his work, and I bring a style to mine that are very, very different. Our titles hopefully reflect a certain amount of eclecticism. There's a common thread through them in that they're good plays and they're literate plays. But each time you step into the Intermediate Theater this year, we hope that your experience is very, very different. Steel Magnolias, if I could dwell on that for just a second, I want to dwell on the season for just a second for the unwashed out there who don't know what we're doing. Steel Magnolias is the newest play in our season. It's only 2 years old, and I'm very close to it because I've directed it. It is about six women who meet over a period of 3 years on Saturday mornings in a beauty shop, and everything that that implies is exactly what you're going to get on stage. It is not men's territory, although there is a deliciousness, at least based on last night, when the men in the audience talked to me about it, about watching the show. It, in many ways, it's a biography. Robert Harling wrote the play. He wrote it out of rage because his sister had died of kidney failure, and she appears in the play. It's extraordinarily funny, a wonderful evening to be spent with six wonderful women. The Miser follows that in January, and this is, I guess, only the second play by Molière that the festival has undertaken. We did a Tartuffe back in the 70s. And Molière, it seems to us, is a playwright for now. His comedies are all about people, and they are a castigation of human vice and folly. And when you look at The Miser and what goes on in The Miser, and you look at Wall Street, you begin to get a sense of why we're producing it. Jerry said that we have a responsibility to produce the classics, but our responsibility extends to communicating them to an audience of today. We don't intend to be a dusty old museum, and hopefully The Miser will be representative of that. It's also a pretty fine show to do in January because it is a comedy, and I understand it rains here a lot in January. And in the winter, it's great fun to laugh. Terra Nova follows that in February. Our season is very tidy. It's like a play a month. It's a little shocking to us when you can open a Romeo and Juliet or a Cyrano in February and run it through Halloween. And we opened November 12th and closed December 3rd. It's a totally different world here. In February, we're doing Terra Nova by Ted Talley, which is a script that has been kicking around the festival for a number of years. It's a rather passionate American play about a British subject. In 1911, Scott took an expedition of British men to the South Pole. Amundsen raced him with the Norwegians. The Norwegians got there first and returned. The British never returned. And this play is the story of the British. It's a wonderful, I call it a fantasy. And it's about heroism and how that concept affects people. It is also an opportunity. When we choose a season, we must think about many different things. How you serve the talent that is available to you. Some of that talent is design talent. And here is an opportunity to put a suggestion or a representation of the Antarctic and the Southern Lights on stage. When you, as happened to me, when you give that to a designer, their eyes light up. It's a wonderful thing. We serve. We serve ourselves, we serve our collaborators, and we serve you. In a funny way, we're a service industry. Our last show is something that I'm very excited about because it's my first opportunity ever to significantly work with Jerry. We are closing the season with Shakespeare, and we've chosen one of the least produced shows, one of the romances of Shakespeare. It's Pericles, which is kind of an epic story of a young prince who journeys on the seas, through storms, island to island, finds a family, loses a family, magically is restored. There are crazy old magicians. There are pirates. There are evil women. Everything you could possibly want in a play. Virtuous daughters. Incest. And Shakespeare wrote this. I'm not making this up. Jerry and I are going to co-direct that show, which is kind of the idea of collaboration in a perfect nutshell. And it's a terribly exciting thing to me. Where we will go beyond this first season is a little difficult to determine at this point because of the getting to know you process. It's like a little like a Rodgers and Hammerstein tune or something. We need to get to know you more. I think it important that those of you who do not understand our definition begin to. There is the question I am asked most frequently is, what is your relationship with Ashland? And of course, we carry up to Portland 53 years worth of experience, trial and error, pleasure, knowledge, professionalism, whatever words you choose to use. We are unique, however, our definition is unique. The Oregon Shakespeare Festival now exists as an entity with two faces, if you will. One is called Ashland, one is called Portland Center Stage. Our presence here is so remarkable because our board of directors and the staff in Ashland decided not to make the move until it was proven that Portland wanted it. And we're only here because that proof came in. Portland Center Stage is, and will continue to be, financially independent of Ashland, though we operate under the same corporate name, and though we operate with the same board of directors, and the same executive director, artistic director, and general manager. And all those people sort of got together and decided that I should be the guy in Portland. I'm grateful, what can I say? And it's our job. We have a staff here. We have a fairly large staff right now, as a matter of fact. We're 50 people strong. 50 new jobs in theater exist in Portland where they did not exist before. And we are all living here and trying to take a pulse. In terms of our position in the theater community, the other most asked question, I think we're a member of it. I don't really think we're here to show them how it's done because they've been doing it for many, many years, some of them very successfully, many of them very successfully. I think we're here to be a member of a theater community. If, in the long haul, Portland Center Stage can simply turn a few more people on to theater so that they go to see, instead of 3 shows a year, they go to see 12 shows a year, and we're only offering 5, and the storefront is offering some, and the New Rose, and Portland Civic are offering some, then as a member of a theater community, we are successful. And we're not here to prove anything. We're here to serve. And that's it in a nutshell. And now, we're supposed to entertain questions.
Yeah.
All right, so Jerry, get up here. And
first question will be from Ned Hayes.
Oh, you have to come to the microphone. I
like this. Oh, yeah, I've got to stand right up.
Can I be one down there?
This is a question possibly for Dennis at this point. But I've heard a great deal about the educational outreach program that you have at Ashland. And I know that some students come in groups from quite great distances to enjoy that. I just wonder if you can remark on the extent to which you're going to be able to do that in Portland for the Portland community.
Sure. As everything is evolving down there at the Performing Arts Center where we're concerned, the educational program is also evolving. We're a month old, and what we've set up this year, which has been successful once, and we'll see next Wednesday, another degree of success or failure, I suppose, is a student matinee program. For each of the productions this year, we're offering a student matinee, a very low cost ticket offered to educators, and with that ticket we offer them a pre-show educational forum where I will come in with a representative from design, a representative from the cast, and do a sort of prepared presentation based on the play and the production of the play. Then the students can see the play, and afterwards they have an opportunity to meet with the cast in terms of questions and answers. So it's this little package on an afternoon that is available and hopefully proves to be educational. We are beginning the plans, which are probably 2 years away, of a sort of outreach program which will go beyond bringing people to the theater, which will take us into the schools. Ashland has an extraordinarily successful outreach program that is just ending up right now. And in the Portland area, there have been two or three teams of actors over the last month and a half who have been in the schools representing the Oregon Shakespeare Festival. So in a way, we rely on that as well, because those actors can represent not only Ashland, but Portland Center Stage, although we ultimately hope to develop our own program here. And, you know, as much as possible, if an educator is unable to make the special Wednesday matinee, we will make certain parts of that available at an evening performance or some other performance. So we try, and we're still investigating. If anybody has any ideas, let me know. That's what we need to know. What else?
Me?
Why not?
Alan Oliver, City Club. I wonder if there are other instances in this country of theaters that have put programs in other cities beyond where they originated. The Guthrie, for example, does it have a satellite company? Are there other places that have had experience in this regard, and what has been their success or failure? And secondly, even in this early stage, would it be possible to speculate on whether Ashland would consider having further satellite companies?
Oh, God.
Okay, the last part of the question is answered. let's not speculate, okay?
It's sort of theater or us.
Yeah, really. Oh, God. One in every town. You know, well, traditionally the way theaters reach other audiences, other cities, is with the tour. Seattle Rep tours down here to Portland. The Guthrie puts out tours that go all over the country. And that is traditionally how they operate as a satellite in another city. In American theater, the Arizona Theater Company has a theater in Phoenix and a theater in Tucson. However, the identity of that is very, very different, because both are subscription theaters, and what they do is mount Cat on a Hot Tin Roof in Tucson, then move it to Phoenix. Every show plays both cities. we're here, we've grown from an 11-play repertoire to a 16-play repertoire because we are producing a body of, we're producing a totally different body of work. Someone said, writing about Heartbreak House, that Heartbreak House was the first show produced by the Oregon Shakespeare Festival that was not never seen in Ashland. Isn't that an amazing thing? And so consequently, we're dedicated to a separate body of work up here, which makes us very different from Arizona Theater Company. On the international level, I guess one of the things we've appeared in the press saying, a model that we looked at, I don't think we've studied it terribly intimately. Philosophically, it suits our needs a lot, is the Royal Shakespeare Company in London. I'm not saying we're the Royal Shakespeare Company, but for many, many years they existed in Stratford and then opened the satellite company in London. And that company had a, ultimately, over a number of years, a very profound influence on the artistic body of work as a whole. And obviously, we're, you know, we talk about how we're here to serve Portland and all that kind of stuff, but I think you have to understand that we're also a tad bit selfish. That there isn't some way that we can expand, if there isn't some way that we can expand our artistic horizons by our presence in Portland, for us, for Dennis Bigelow, for Jerry Turner, for an actor who suddenly has a gracious new stage to perform on, a different audience to perform in front of, if we can't serve ourselves artistically, there really isn't any reason to be here. That this is also something of a self-serving move as well. And those are the only theaters I know about. Now, there's probably one in China that I just don't know about. And no, we're not considering another satellite theater at all.
B.J. Seymour, City Club member. What is the function of the preview performances? Is this just a way to get the kinks out, or why do you have previews
to give
instead
the director,
of just an opening night?
To give the director relief. no, it's that first time in front of an audience is an extraordinary event. And speaking very recently, you know, 16 hours ago, we've just spent 3.5 weeks rehearsing a comedy, Steel Magnolias. After about 4 days in a rehearsal studio, it all ceases to be funny to us as we try to figure out who the characters are. The lines are not funny anymore. And come tech week, you know, your eyes are this big and you think, nobody is going to laugh at this show. And you're going to be playing a comedy to absolute silence. Then you get it in front of an audience, and the first thing that happens is someone laughs, and relaxation begins to occur. The chemistry between actor and audience is so crucial. Every time you come to the theater, that this is the opportunity for us to meet an audience, to figure out in the playing of a comedy, to determine where the laughs are, so that we can get the timing down, we can improve, we can hone. It's play practice. Although the production is complete, there is nothing different except a startling sense of immediacy about the preview. Do you want to say anything?
Yeah, I'd just like to add that there's another aspect of that. What Dennis says is all very true. That's the first time you expose it to an audience, and you'd like to have some ability to make small changes, adjustments in view of the way the audience responds. But if you have at the same time that the first audience comes in, all the newspaper men in Oregon coming in to record it, there's something terribly permanent about that. And so what you do is to guarantee that you do get a chance of doing that in two different steps. I remember Ingmar Bergman, a famous Swedish director on all stage as well as film, once decided that the opening night was so traumatic he wanted to eliminate it entirely. And it was remarkable because what he did is began to invite people in to watch his late rehearsals. And so they watched the rehearsals, and then gradually they put on clothes and lights came in and all that kind of stuff. And eventually one day they said, now I think we ought to start charging. But this was a way to take away that fear. It didn't help Bergman at all, because somewhere in the course of it, some newspaper man turned up and recorded it, you know, said, I was over watching the old man Bergman working over there, and boy, is he turning into an asshole. And when he turned up later on, ostensibly at a rehearsal, Bergman slugged him. Always wanted to do that, he said. And I know what he means.
I'm Don Sterling, a member. I guess I'll address this to Mr. Turner, since you made a reference to the architecture of the Elizabethan Theater. We have the red box up there, the Winningstad, in which I understand has some of the characteristics of an Elizabethan theater building. Does that tempt you at all to try it, try using it?
Well, it's a hard question to answer. I think it's easy to make a general kind of statement. Almost any space that you look at tempts you. And it's like having, if you're a mural painter, every wall has an attraction. No, I find it a little awkward. I've not had to mount a play in the Winningstad, but I have been part of a forum there. It's a difficult space, I think. I think it can be quite attractive. I think it might be kind of interesting, depending upon what you're producing there. I just find it's my old theater habits. I've gotten to be an old curmudgeon. I grew up in this particular kind of theater. New stuff makes me nervous. But it's the whole business of sitting up there on the top on what looks to me like a bar stool, resting arms on a thing, and then turning left or right, whichever it is, to see the stage. It's troublesome to me. I understand that there are theaters like that, at least one theater like it in London, that people like very much indeed. So the answer to that is yes, it's kind of tempting, but you'd want to have a spooky, crazy show to put in there, I think. I wouldn't want to see Heartbreak House in it.
Yes, Arnold Kogan, member of the City Club. It had been said early on that you would not be repeating plays between Ashland and Portland, but we noticed that Pericles is being performed here, and as I understand, it's going to be performed in Ashland this season. Can you explain the rationale behind that, and will you be planning similar repeat performances like that in both places?
Oh, I hope so. There's a little, what I think is misinformation there. Perhaps I'm sometimes quoted saying, I did not feel and do not feel that either Ashland or Portland should be regarded as a place to try out a play and then move. The notion that Portland, for example, should become the tryout place, or for that matter, the place that you move to, consistently would be wrong. It would simply turn our organization into a very elaborate touring theater. On the other hand, one of the things that attracted me from the beginning was the sort of thing that the Royal Shakespeare does pretty routinely, that is, having mounted a show in one place, it can move. Frequently, it works the other way around a little bit. Frequently, we have a show that we're particularly fond of in Ashland that opens in August, which for us is rather late. And so it has what we regard as a kind of short run. It's always a little bit heartbreaking to close it down after such a short run. And they had Three Sisters a few years ago, and I was very proud of it. And I thought that would be the kind of thing that we could move to Portland for an opening show in the fall. It was just simply move on. And so I think the opportunity to do that both ways is one of the attractivenesses of it. Again, let me re-emphasize, what you try to avoid is saying, let's start a show in one place or another every time so that we always have an outlet on the road, as it were. The thing I was trying to emphasize in my own remarks is Portland should not be regarded as Ashland's road. That's terribly, terribly important. Or the other way around, for that matter. Because it's too much of a strain to run a road company. Did that answer your question?
Other questions from the floor?
Bill Weber, City Club member. Pardon me. Going back to our board host's question, I'd like to explore a different aspect of that than the answer you gave. And that is, you are what I understand is professional theater. how does a person become a professional actor? Do they go through elementary school, high school, college? Are there professional acting schools? And do you plan anything like that at Ashland or Portland?
I'm not certain I can answer the question very easily. There are professional acting schools all over the country, various successes and failures, I think, in that business. And in a sometimes cynical mood, I'll say, the way a person becomes an actor is he has a curse that he can't escape, a talent somehow that insists upon coming out. Frequently I'm asked by people, say, how do I become a professional actor, or do you think I should become a professional actor? And my response is that if anybody can talk you out of it, then you're not an actor. And so I think that whole business of how one becomes one is very, very difficult to answer. Ideally, I think, an actor develops and grows by training his instrument simultaneously while he's performing. That is to say, he will serve the theater in roles that he's assigned and worked up in, and then he will continue to learn his craft in a studio, a la Stanislavski, and he will pass on what he knows as best he can to somebody else. But that's an awfully elaborate thing to postulate. It in some respects, I think, the whole business of do we intend to have another satellite theater comes in here. Do we intend to have another conservatory? I think not, however desirable it might be. There are other theaters that insist that that is indeed the pattern that should support itself, but I'm uncomfortable with it. There's a lot of other things I'd rather do. You want to comment on it? You want to run a conservatory?
No. Running a theater is fine.
We have time for a few written questions if there are no more questions from the floor. The first one, I'm curious, why the decision to not sell seats in the upper balcony?
Well, I think that's fairly simple. The house, given as it is, with two balconies, is rather too large for theater. It's easier to play, certainly be easier to play without the third balcony. We didn't think we could fill it, not consistently. And I'm pretty certain that that was a good decision. If you consider what would happen if you take exactly the number of patrons we now have this year, spread them into possibility of using the third balcony, you simply would shorten your run. The house is just somewhat too large. And it is also a little uncomfortable. At least I find it so. Sitting in the third balcony, I'm always afraid I'm going to pitch headlong into the orchestra. And it's uncomfortable for actors also, if suddenly you're having to face up. So I think it was interesting that the opening night of Heartbreak House, where we did use the balcony, was comfortable for us. But I wouldn't want to do it very often. I think it's a danger to do it too often.
This question is addressed to you, Jerry. Why Heartbreak House as the inaugural play? The acting was wonderful, but the play is, well, not all that wonderful.
Well, I just have to quarrel with you. I think it's really one of the best plays written in the 20th century. I think it probably still begs, why that play? Why not St. Joan? Why not Major Barber? It's tidier, of course. It's a smaller cast, things of this kind, but it has an elegance in it. I think the answer to why I'm particularly fond of it is I think it's consistently funny and also very, very serious. And I think that both I and the actors had a tendency to be amazed at how serious Shaw was behind his ability to laugh. That's one of the most remarkable gifts, I think, that a person can have, is to treat life as a very serious but very funny joke. And I think it's very, very appealing. I think, you know, there's certainly room for various opinions on that. Generally speaking, the play was an awkward piece in Shaw's canon because it was written at a time when he was not terribly popular in Great Britain. He disapproved of World War I. Since then, I noticed from a variety of sources, most of the Shavians think that maybe this is his best play. So I'll leave that for you to discuss.
Rob Hildenbrand, City Club member. Could you give us some perspective on how responsive Portland Center Stage is going to be to local talent and maybe even playwrights for new plays in the city?
Sure. Well, first of all, we've done about 6 days worth of auditioning in town here. I've seen about 220 Portland actors at this point. And from Steel Magnolias through Pericles, at least, there are Portland actors in all of those shows, people that I've met here who have auditioned here. I think it a mistake for any theater to limit itself exclusively or even by establishing a percentage of the number of people in a show from their hometown. I think that we have the responsibility to seek the best talent imaginable, and we have the resources to meet the talent, whether the talent comes here to us or whether we go off on audition tours. And in order to serve an audience, it's our responsibility to get the best talent available. And that's pretty much the point of view. It, of course, when you're trying to build a theater in a city, for a city, there is a segment of the population, I think, that very much wants to see the local talent represented. And so you try, at least I as a producer, try to keep that in mind when I'm weighing people. If there is someone in Portland who is as good as anybody else that I can find, well then, of course, hire the Portland-based person. It's good community relation, or theater community relation at least, for those people to work together.
This question is addressed to Jerry. What is a sophisticated audience to which you referred? How does one become sophisticated? Can I take a course in it at Portland State University?
Yeah. Is that one of those poisonous words? I think what I had in mind there is, again, working on Heartbreak House, I had to go back to read quite a great deal of background in Shaw, and it was very interesting. There was a new biography, first volume of his life, that just came out this year. It's really very good, and I recommend it to you wholeheartedly. And he was, during World War I, concerned that suddenly they had a whole new audience, an audience in khaki. And he was rather awed by the fact that their entertainment level had shifted radically. What they were used to in the West End were from a particular kind of leisured social class. And suddenly you had the boys in khaki coming back from the war, and what they wanted to see was a lot of songs, hear a lot of songs, and see a lot of girls. And he thought how difficult it really is to achieve an audience such as the one that he and Sir Henry Irving and Ellen Terry and people like that were familiar with. It's not that they're inaccessible, they're quite accessible, but that they can read the language that is being presented in those West End plays. And so when I say unsophisticated, it isn't derogatory or snobbish or anything like this. It just means that you may find an unsophistication that the city lives in. There's nothing bad about that, but that it's very much more difficult to leap into the world of Shakespeare or Beethoven or Mozart or what have you. That takes a knowingness that I think is something that has to be achieved. and I think it's achievable, but it isn't automatic. And I think sometimes an author's plays tend to sink as they get older. You look at what seemed very exciting in 1927, you say, why do you suppose we ever got excited about it for? It's very primitive. And at the same time, there are other things that tend to rise on that scale, saying, I didn't understand that when I read it when I was 16, but now I do. King Lear became that to me. I didn't understand King Lear at all till I reached 60. Now I'm beginning to know about it.
I guess we have... I hear you. I guess we have time for one final question. This one was addressed to Dennis. In view of the fact that Portland is now your home, do you see yourself taking a leadership role in the Portland arts community, and what role?
Great. Well, the immediate urge is to say yes. Of course, I must take a leadership role. But simply because I have a job, simply because I have a resume, doesn't mean that I can come in and become a leader in an arts community in a city. I think that's a little unrealistic. I think first, I don't want to be known because of past work. I want to be known because of the work that I do. And if I can establish with my work a leadership role in the Portland arts community, then there it is. Our theater, I think, has to become as productive as it can in the arts community. And to that end, I think our theater has, for instance, joined the Arts Alliance and the Portland Area Theater Alliance. I serve on a number of committees. Our marketing director serves on a number of committees. If we have any expertise, and in variety there is always expertise, in the list of 5 or 7 theaters that the marketing director and I have worked at, we've had different input. We can share that. Whether or not it's picked up, I do not know. But I don't want to just be a leader. I don't want to come here as a leader. I want to prove myself with my work and evolve into something like that.
Thanks very much to both of you, Dennis and Jerry. I think this club is certainly, and this audience, again, welcomes both of you warmly, and we look forward to you a lot of great productions in the future. Thanks very much for being with us.
Thank you.
Thank you.